I've already screwed up making coffee.
I'm just going to put that right there. And I'm going to grind these beans. I really should see what our shots are. Can you tell that I'm not good at any of this? If you can tell that I'm not good at any of this, please write "you're terrible" and leave Twitch in the chat room right now. And we'll see how many of those we get by the end of it. Alright, put that there. Oh, crap.
Wait.
Oh, damn it. Isn't this working? Plugging this into a thing on the floor. There we go. So now, let's get the big old French press. Super strong. It's four. Oh, crap. Oh, crap, you guys. I didn't have enough water. Oh, what an asshole I am. I'm the biggest asshole. I didn't even conceive of that. What a monumental blunder. What a blunder. I'm screaming. Sorry. Let's see how fast we can heat this up. I've already screwed up the coffee. I've screwed up the coffee to such a tremendous level. There was like two things I wanted to do today. Talk about, well, number one, I was supposed to do with the thing with bread. And I can't get in touch with bread. So that's already a fail. Then I wanted to have coffee. Then I wanted to talk about Star Wars. And as of now, I have failed on all three fronts. We are 1, 2, 3, totally failed. Let me go ahead and see what the chat says. Here we go. Wow, this is pretty cool. I like this handheld. So that's our rig right there. You should go back to bed. You're right. You're right, man. When you're right, you're right. And you? You're always right. I don't even know if this is gonna work. Like, does this work? Who does French press? Like, if I just throw more hot water in there, like, is it gonna taste like garbage? Is there such a thing as over-steeping French press? Also, how fast can water boil? Somebody look that one up. Wow, this has gotten off to a really rollicking start, right? This has definitely gotten off to the kind of start that everybody can admire. Maybe you want to know, through my ample foibles, I will be more of a sympathetic streamer, right? Person, somebody for whom you can look into the screen and find your own faults in. You can identify with me, and we can all grow together. Or you can just laugh at me for being the fucko who didn't know how to make coffee. Probably gonna be the second one, isn't it? Yeah, I wouldn't blame you. I don't blame you. We're gonna see if this coffee blows, man. There's a very, 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 very good chance this coffee is going to just be garbage. Garbage coffee for garbage people. There's a chance. There's a very good chance. Let's go ahead and take a look at water boiling here. All right, well,
just to get ahead of the chat a little bit, who saw Rogue One, and do you guys want to talk about it in a spoilery way, or do you want to talk about it in a non-spoilery way? That's the question. Do you want Rogue One spoilers, or do you not want Rogue One spoilers? Okay, here we go. Put this down here. There we go. Off, put this back where it belongs.
All right, here we go. Now we're back. Put a lid on it. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, here we go. It's impossible to bindle if Ashley isn't cooking. You're terrible and you roll poorly, roll blunts. Ashley is feeling a disturbance in the force. 3.5 minutes max time to steep my French press. Put a lid on it. I don't want spoilers, but I can mute you. All right, so non-spoilers. Non-spoilers. Let me ask y'all something. And you want to know what? I'm going to go ahead and tweet this out. I want to get folks in here on this. I want to have ourselves a merry little Christmas when it comes to Rogue One chat. Okay. Non spoiler Rogue One chat right now. twitch.tv/JustinRYoung. Okay. So, where do we start? Let me just make this a conversation. How about that? How about we start in this being a conversation? And let's begin with your expectations of what the movie are, what the movie is. Do you expect a war movie? Because there's a very, 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 very interesting question to be asked about what is indeed a war movie. In fact, I'll tell you what. Let me ask y'all this. What is your favorite war movie? That's a good question. What is your favorite war movie? Because that might shape what we expect, right? From this, a Star Wars war movie. The Bio Cow expects a rom-com. Man, I mean, it's not even like you're all that different. Reverend Buck says, is it the Star Wars Dirty Dozen? That is a great comparison. Or at least to the expectations, right? Dirty Dozen, if you're not familiar, is the idea that a bunch of unwantables, you know, go on a mission. They are dirty, there's a dozen of them, and they got to go behind enemy lines on kind of a death mission. For example, Inglourious Basterds, war movie, right? So listen, we can. I don't want to get into spoilers. So if you saw the movie last night, try to keep them to a minimum. But I was talking to a friend. Let's call him for the sake of this conversation. My friend. There are only a couple kind of war movies, right? There are movies about preparing to go to war, you know, like Full Metal Jacket. There are movies about the horrors of war, Saving Private Ryan, Apocalypse Now, that kind of stuff, right? And then there are the spy movies, right? The behind enemy lines, double agent kind of movies. And I don't know if y'all are with me here, but my favorite of that genre is either the like, yeah. So there we go. Octasco says, you know, Guns of the Navarone, Where Eagles Dare. Absolutely. The Longest Day. Man, we got some, who knew? Who knew that Friday morning, man, we got some more movie buffs up in here. I got y'all. Great. Great taste. So I don't know really how to peel this onion first. I don't know what level we want to go to immediately. Thin Red Line, another great one. More recent. Band of Brothers, fantastic. You want to know what all those movies did? All those movies were great for two reasons. Number one, you understood the conflict. And number two, you had investment in the characters, right? You cared about the characters. You wanted to see them achieve their goal. Is that fair to say? In all those movies that we just named, all these great war movies, right? All of them have this one thing in common. And that is that we care about the characters. So without going into spoilers, allow me to simply say I was very, very, very disappointed in Rogue One. And I'm going to go ahead and say, I'm going to go ahead and take the L. That I think it's my own expectations. Partly. There are some parts of the movie that I think are unforgivable. And it blows my mind. Blows my mind. Blows my mind that there's anybody out there. Anybody. Anybody who tells you this is the best Star Wars movie ever is a liar, and they're lying to you. Immediately distrust that person and anybody, anything that they say furthermore. Even if it's your parents. Even if it's your significant other. Even if it's your child. If they say it's the best Star Wars movie ever, you no longer are able to place any degree of trust in it. Yeah, it. I'm stripping them of their personhood. Is Rogue One anything like Charlie Wilson's War? That was the one with Tom Hanks, right? Ghetto BP, is there going to be a spoiler show with Scott? Indeed there is. Hotline Monday, next Monday. Go see the show. Go see Rogue One. And then Scott and I are going, it's going to be lit. Oh, it's going to be on. It's going to be real on. Because here were my expectations going in. And part of this was based on the trailer. That movie had extensive reshoots. And I don't know enough about the making of the film to say whether or not it was a good or bad decision. To be honest with you, I don't. You know, I wanted a spy movie. I wanted a can we trust them story. I wanted a very specific kind of war movie. And then as soon as I saw, oh man, as soon as I saw in those trailers and those posters, all the tropical stuff, right? All the tropical stuff. I was like, yes, this is the Vietnam War movie. JV Phobic says, total guess, but you got to figure at the end of the movie it has to feature R2. I can't wait to see it on Saturday. You see R2. Spoiler. Probably not where you think, but you see R2. Tropic Thunder. Great. Love Tropic Thunder. I guess, I don't know. I mean, have you guys ever had this situation where you envisioned a movie in your head and then the movie that you saw was not that movie and you resented it? Because I think that that's a fair amount of why I disliked I disliked Rogue One as much as I did. I think that that's part of it. Because, you know, the fact that the plot of the movie wasn't what I wanted and the story of the movie wasn't what I wanted and the characters weren't what I wanted, I can blame on me. But there are elements of this movie that I think are unforgivable. And I'll just say this. The way that they handled Darth Vader in Rogue One is embarrassing. It's bad. It makes me like Darth Vader less as a character. And this is like against all of my personal my personal like philosophy, because I always think that more is better. More, the more you can do, the better off it is. Learning EXP, even with that final scene, yes, with that final scene, because you want to know why learning EXP? You want to know why? Because that should have been the first scene. So then we could have actually, like, had tension and had weight. Like, once the characters that we follow throughout the entire movie are no longer in the picture, then we know the rest. It's called Episode 4. A New Hope. Like, so, yeah, no, it's cool action, but it is totally devoid of stakes. Totally, totally, totally devoid of stakes. I mean, it's badass, but it's just sort of like, you know, it's just sort of Darth Vader, I'm Darth Vader, look at me, whip-bop-y, ding-dong-doo, lip-a-lip-bop, I'm Darth Vader, look at me, bah. No, wait. I'm Darth Vader. Oops. Crap. Carmigan says, I think looking at this thing for stakes is the wrong thing. No, man, number one, I was at the Alamo Draft House, so I could have got a stake if I won. It's not stakes. It's not like I need the fate of the galaxy, right? I'm down for it to be a tiny little grimy street-level story. But I gotta, you know, I gotta know who I'm rooting for, right? Like, I gotta know who's who. Like, I gotta, like Darkwing Duck. I know that I like Darkwing Duck. I know that I dislike Negaduck, right? I know that I like Launchpad. Like, I know what their points of view are. Xbox 8, it could have been a great heist movie. I wanted to be a Behind Enemy Lines kind of movie. That's one thing, right? JV Phobic says, I'm not sure who the protagonist is. No, I mean, I think this movie has a fairly clear protagonist, and that is, that's, what's it called? That's what's her butt? Jyn Erso? Ursa? Ursa? So I think that that's there, right? Like, you know, you know who she is. I just don't know if, you know, I don't know, like, why. The problem with her is not that she's not the protagonist. The problem with her is that she's passive the entire movie. And literally all the most interesting things that happen to her off screen. We have more people tell us in words about some interesting stuff that happened to her off screen than we do see interesting things happen to her. Gigaloop says, I liked it because it felt different than the canon Star Wars movies, a grittier war movie, I guess, which I ordinarily don't enjoy. I'm listening to the prequel now. Wonder if it'll help. I mean, maybe. I don't know, man. I hate crapping on this kind of stuff. As much as, you know, for whatever reason now, I guess I'm getting a bit of a reputation around our little circle of friends for being a bit of a contrarian. Like, I like to argue about things for argument's sake, but I don't think I am, man. I'm a mark ass buster for all the geek stuff. I came out here and raved about Doctor Strange, you know. And let me just compare this to Episode 7, right? Because I think that there are some real plot contrivances in Episode 7. I'll ask: is it really anti-Trump? If it was anti-Trump, I can't tell. I don't think it was anti-Trump. I mean, it's not like anybody was like, we've got to stop this Trump character. You know, I don't know. So I didn't see that. But let's look at Episode 7, right? Like, that's a movie that has, and let me just get a, let me go ahead and get your guys' opinion. What do you guys think of Episode 7? What did you think of Episode 7? I just want to ask. Maybe I'm anti-Trump. I didn't vote for him, so, you know, take that for what it is. Yeah, we got a lot of loves. A lot of love for Episode 7 right now in the chat room. A lot of love. So, Carmackin says, fun, not as good as the Marvel movies. Episode 7 was good, but I didn't like the ending. Didn't even know there was a 7. Oh, your dad plays. What a goose. Makes me cry every time I watch it, but I'm a weirdo. Cool. So let me ask y'all something. What is Finn's motivation as a character? What is Finn's motivation? In fact, I'm not even going to wait. I'm just going to tell you. Finn's motivation, I think clearly, and if anybody else has another, you know, answer to it, then, you know, we could. But Finn's motivation is he doesn't want to be a stormtrooper no more. He wants to do something else. And then he falls into the Rebel Alliance, and that's it. Goes from leaving the Empire to helping Rey. Goes on a journey. Then he kind of falls for Rey. He becomes part of this, you know, patchwork piece of resistance. Cool. Rey wants to understand a little bit more about her family. She's waiting for her family, and then she makes the decision to leave her homeland to go in search of the answers instead of waiting for the answers to come to her. Kylo Ren is trying to fall into the footsteps of his grandfather and not his father, and he battles the dark side. He bolsters the dark side by fighting off the light side. Like, and we can get into spoilers. We can do another one of these and we can get into spoilers about it, or we're going to talk about it on Hotline Monday on Monday. But I don't know what the active decisions are. And that's before we get into the world. Like, I don't even know about the logic of this world, man. Like, I don't know. Now I'm just going to get mean. And now I'm just going to get meh. This is different than my Westworld criticism. My Westworld criticism was that this is a very, very, very smart show with a very, very, very interesting premise and some very high-level interesting ideas. And I was frustrated by the story that they wrapped around it because I did not think... I found the story more specifically not beyond not being good. It wasn't that I thought it was not good. I thought it was frustrating. I thought it was deliberately holding off elements for us to deal with, right? I didn't like it. Night Barbie says, whoa, you look like a real-life painting or an art piece. Yeah, girl. Yeah, Night Barbie, what you know. Did I read any of the prequel stuff leading into Rogue One? No, I didn't. I mean, I very, very, very rarely read that. So, all right. We don't have to talk about Rogue One anymore. I guess Brett's not hitting me up. We can give we can try to give Brett a call. Hold on. He's probably not up. Oh, wait. Hold on. Up late. Forgot to set an alarm, but I'm around and conscious now. Oh. Come on over, baby. Cool. Your dad plays jury. How much did you pay Night Barbie to say that? That's for me to know and you to find out. So, all right. So, it looks like we are going to do the Brett and Justin Work From Home podcast, which is cool. Might have to put on a little more music just to get everything set up. Although, I guess we could just kind of, we could pile everybody into here. I do need to go get the... Get the other mic. All right. How many of you guys know who Brett Rounsville is? I don't even know, man. It looks like we have mostly regulars, right? But I'm curious. I'm curious to see who knows who is. Did I send Brett a you up text? No. I mean, I sent him one around like 9:30 to see whether or not he wanted to come in. BioCow, Tensor Guy. Okay, yeah. So all the regulars obviously know who he is. Refractal Studios. So at some point, Brett and I realized after the election that we both work from home now. And so we can do a fun little podcast. So we're going to do a fun little podcast. It's going to be great. But if there are any topics that you guys would like to suggest, then please go ahead and throw it in there. I've seen him on NSFW. Oh, wow. Your dad plays. Old school. Old school, dude. So wait, your dad plays. Are you not familiar with Night Attack? Did you follow us on over to Night Attack? Or are you just saying that you haven't seen him since NSFW show? OG chat realm. Yeah. Oh, no. Y'all are my best friends. I will say, man, I will admit that this delay is a little hard to get over. It is definitely something that requires a bit of a learning curve. I first started listening when you were trying to lose the explicit tag on NSFW. Oh, Jesus. Wow. That was Hotel Rwanda for dogs, right? That was an epic episode. We did that for one episode, and then we were told to stop doing that. Do you get a lower latency option if you're partnered? Yeah. All right, here we go. Making his way into the studio. It's Brett the Amtrek around Seville. We're live on Twitch. We're gonna try to stream this live on Twitch. Here, come talk to the people, and I'm gonna go get the other mic.
Hi, everybody. I have a quick story. So I don't set an alarm clock anymore, and That's mostly because I have a child and a wife, and one of them will wake me up at 8:30, no matter what. As it turns out, I don't know where my wife and child are right now. I have no idea. I woke up at like 10:30 and no one was in the house, and there was a note to feed the dog. I'm sure everything's fine. I mean,
do you think the wife or the child left that?
I, like, the handwriting wasn't very good. That's all I'm
so saying. Either. So really, we're no closer to solving this. All right, here. Hold on to that. Let me get you a chair.
Hold on to both mics. Hi, Chat Realm. Long time no see. Oh, my gosh. Justin's apartment. Super warm compared to mine. Mr. Moneybags over here. I was just commenting on how hot your apartment is.
Ooh la la.
Dry that off.
Just gonna both get the one shot.
Oh, D-Ross, 1705. Hello, hello, hello. Did you get your pocket door sorted out? Did you have a pocket door problem?
I did have a pocket door problem. I sort of got it sorted out. So the problem was that the walls were too close together in one spot. So the door was rubbing, which means I needed to find a way to spread the door apart. But I only had like a 2.4-inch hole to stick something in to spread the things apart. And I came up empty trying to find that, but I found a better solution. I took all of the molding off of the door and hung it all up crooked. And so now nothing rubs. And you can only tell if you use a level that nothing is right.
So wait, so what were you trying to do again?
It was, you know, that pocket door that goes from the kitchen into like the rest of the house.
Gotcha.
There's like an open hole there. And then
I didn't
the door
know
slides
that.
Out.
I didn't know my
what
my,
pocket doors are called.
My dilettante.
So maybe you remember like that thing like
yes.
rubs like super hard
yeah,
and you try
yeah,
to close
yeah, yeah.
it. So I was going to actually replace the door. I took pieces of chunks of things apart, tore the door out, put a new door in.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until then that I realized the problem wasn't the door, the whole wall is crooked.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. And not only is the whole wall crooked, but like the pocket door inset that's in there is made of metal, so it's not like you can just like shave bits of something off.
Yeah.
So I was going to try and bend things in there, and I couldn't find anything small enough that would do that.
Small enough to bend?
Small enough to, like, fit inside of a hole and then bend two walls apart.
Oh, Jesus. All right, check, check, check. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Are levels good? Levels good?
Check. Breaker, breaker, 1-9er.
This is my favorite text message I get every month. AT&T free message. Mm. Your data usage this month has reached 16.5 gigabytes. If you exceed 22 gigabytes before your next cycle on the 2nd of January, you can still use unlimited data. However, reduced times, blah, 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 blah. Listen, you know the deal you made, bitch. I'm on that unlimited, baby.
I got
that. And I'm going to use every inch of it.
Every inch of unlimited?
Unlimited. And now they're like, oh, we're going to slow you down. Do it. Do it. I dare you. I dare you. They're like, well, when you get to, I mean, I think 22 gigs is reasonable. Uh-uh.
I didn't pay for reasonable. I paid for everything.
Oh, man. Now that Netflix lets me download stuff, I'm just all of it. How much Netflix? All Netflix. Every bit of Netflix.
I just
want to
make sure there's a good
Netflix.
Backup of Netflix in case things go wrong.
I just, yeah, I want to make sure that Netflix is in my pocket at all times.
Does Amtrak's wife have a job? Before I answer that, I would love to know why you want to know that question. Or why you want to know the answer to that question.
Wait, why?
I feel like that's a jab. I feel like it's a jab of some kind, and I want to know what's going on here.
Oh, to the whole work from home. By the way, do you like the name Brett and Justin work from home?
I think that's
brilliant,
don't
best,
you?
Right?
Yeah.
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 Also, it'll fool people into thinking that we're doing, like,
that
an
we
actual
work.
Yeah. From the height of Western decadence. Your weird dolphin laugh is peeking everything out. It's great.
God, sorry.
All right.
So let's change this to talk shows.
Curious about households. So my wife does have a job. She works part time. So 20 hours a week, she is out of the house, and I am the primary caregiver to little Scarlett. Today, she switched her days off from Monday to Friday, but I don't know where she is right now or where my child is or whether or not they're both safe. But I assume the best.
Sure. All right. You want to know what? We're gonna lean on you guys here. So literally, we're just gonna do like an improv troupe. Like, I just need words so we can just like have a word to start about, and this then we'll just go from there.
This is kind of the We Do Reviews idea.
It is kind of the We Do Reviews, except, you know, I don't know. Well, now we don't have to show a video game on screen anymore. Now we can just talk.
That's good.
Yeah.
Hey, can we talk about the other idea on camera too, and like get a feel for whether or not that'd be fun?
Sure, we can do whatever the hell we want, man. How the F do you live in Oakland on 20 hours and Mission Pick?
Well, luckily, Mission Pick makes me an enormous amount of negative money.
So start there.
And so I leverage that negative money into pity from my wife.
Yeah.
Actually, I mean, the honest answer is just that we don't spend money on anything but Oakland. So our lifestyle is pretty simple.
All right. Single female lawyer is going to be the name of the episode.
Oh, all right. What's a single female? Not a conjoined twin?
That's who the lawyers are. That's where they go. Negative money equals the best money.
She lives in this world of conjoined twin lawyers, and she's the only single female lawyer.
All right, hold on for 2 seconds.
Hold on, I'm going.
No, we have to.
I wanted them to ask them about the other thing.
Okay, we have to start the show. Oh, we have to find a way.
All right, Jesus, fine. Single conjoined twins.
A single female lawyer. That's what I said. It's called.
That's what I said.
All right. Hi, everybody. This is a new show. We call Brad and Justin Work From Home. It's because I'm Justin.
And I'm Brad.
And we work from home.
Now.
Now. We didn't used to before.
Yeah. I kind of like the now, though.
Did you get a call from our old job? I guess you're still technically a little bit with our old job.
Yeah, I help them out now and again. A call about what, though?
I got a call. They were like, it's like one of those, like, hey, babe, you up? Like, you know,
booty calls. Like this one? I just don't answer these.
Is that oh, Jesus. I'm just looking. All right, so for those of you who don't know, Brett is still, like, I guess tangentially connected to a team building company. We both love it. We think they're great.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they're amazing. But literally, I'm just looking at an avalanche of unresponded to texts from December 2nd onward, just asking, like, hey, can you help? Another day goes by. Hey, there's another game. Can you help with that? Hey, can you just hop on a phone call with us at some point in the next year? Hey, I need you to do another thing. Can you do that today? And then at the end, when she just sent a strong emoji, like a flexing bicep emoji.
In my defense, I do still work with them and have run a game for them like in the past 2 weeks. I just wait for it to be so important that they call me. Like it has to be double extra important before I do anything.
I got a call from them yesterday about like, hey man, we got there's a new attitude around this place. We got cool things going on.
Uh huh.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I just like
we're hipping with it.
Also, apparently here. I mean, I guess now I'm kind of regretting even just bringing up their business like on a random podcast. But here is something I do want to talk about. They're having their Christmas party.
Yeah.
On Monday.
Yeah.
A Monday, 5 o'clock to like 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
Christmas party.
Granted, they are a real business in the same way we work from home, and that like they can just say like, "Hey, everyone, why don't you f off today, and we'll go have a party."
Yeah,
like,
but
they don't need. To like they like half of the people that work there won't know that it's Monday.
Yeah, but like all of their significant others and friends will, right?
That's a problem for another person.
I mean, no, but that's not. That's the whole point. Is everybody gets together and, like, you bring your wife and you bring your boyfriend, you bring whatever, and they're all like, oh, my God, let's all, like, oh, yeah. He keeps talking about that thing. Like, and then and everybody gets too drunk and it's a fun time.
Yeah.
Like, what are you doing on Monday? That's crazy.
That is weird. They are doing a thing over the week. I don't know why we're talking about this. This is
I just want to know about, I'm going to need to say on them, just in general. What is the optimum time for a holiday party?
Oh, my gosh. It totally depends on the company. I would say from most companies, the optimum time for a holiday party is never.
Never?
Never. From most companies.
Why?
Because I would say, like...
You don't like him? Guys, no, we're streaming live on Twitch right now. I want you guys to help out on this. What is the best time to do a holiday party? Friday, Saturday, early in the season, late in the season?
Here's the rub, right? Like, no matter what, you're going to work at a time you don't necessarily want to. Like, best case scenario, the party is like at a convenient time, like Friday at 5, but then you worked all week and you just want to go home. Then, like, your next option is Saturday and Sunday, which is way more free. Your family gets to come and everything. But if you don't love what you do and where you do it, then you're going somewhere you don't want to be at a place that you're at all week long to hang out with people you don't like all that much.
So Princess Dagger says 9:30 never. So she's with you.
Yeah.
RG Manifesto, Friday the week before. We had an office happy hour this last Wednesday. Seemed kind of odd, but the best time for a holiday party is in early January.
Oh, yes. That's when the best President's Day parties happen.
That's, oh, dude, those President's parties are lit, boy!
MLK happy hour!
Friday at 3, no guests and a lot of booze. I had my company Christmas party last week, Friday evening.
Hmm. So you don't mind staying at work, or did you go off-site? Like, that's another thing there, too, is, like, most companies, I mean, we work closely with a ton of companies in situations just like this.
I mean, yeah, and so I mean, I don't think it's telling tales out of school that the company that we used to work for was, like, a go-to party favor for holiday parties. We did a ton of holiday party things during the season.
Yeah, and so most companies are looking to not spend money on a holiday party, so they have it in their office to begin with.
Yeah.
And so you're already stuck. You're trapped. You're right where you don't want to be 40 hours a week.
No, you're right. No, all right, so here's what's BS.
Yeah.
This is, to me, the worst holiday parties. Holiday parties that are in the office,
mm-hmm.
far lamer, just go to a bar. Like, it doesn't take much.
Yeah.
Just throw a credit card down behind the bar. Easy peasy lemon squeezy.
Yeah.
Like that's all you really need. Right.
This whole thing. Anything else is overthinking it.
This whole, like, oh, well, we'll just go to Costco. I mean, like, really? For what we're going to pay for the bar? You know, we might as well just get a bunch of Coors. Like,
yeah. I mean,
no.
even if, say, that's your thing, we live in California. Go have a picnic or something. Just literally get out of the building.
Get
and
out
that's
of the
priority
building.
One.
Number one, I'm not down with you with this picnic thing. But yes.
I'm not saying picnics are great. I'm saying the building is that awful.
I would say if people at our old job said, oh, our holiday party is going to be a picnic next week, I would spit in their face.
What if they said it's going to be a picnic with unlimited booze?
We're talking.
Keep going.
We're talking.
Keep going.
Yeah. Is this picnic at 7 o'clock and indoors? If so,
all right. Starting to feel it. Starting to feel it.
Here's what I think. This is my pitch. I'm a fan of the early holiday season holiday party.
Oh, so not like early in day. Like, you want it in July.
No, not July. Yes,
Christmas
in July.
Yeah, it's a thing. I've heard of it.
Oh, wait, hold on. No, that's a thing. Has there ever been a Christmas in July movie?
Oh, I'm sure.
Like,
how
not
could there
about,
not have been?
Not a, like one where it's like oh, like I'm a alcoholic and I'm robbing a bank. Like, and it happens to be Christmas in July. But like Christmas in July, the movie.
Like Santa falls off of a rooftop. Into the snow in, say, Alaska, so the permafrost
doesn't melt
until July.
Yeah.
And that's when you discover his dead body, put on his coat, and are like, oh, my God, I have to save Christmas. And your
in
wife
July.
Is like, but it's July, honey. and then the beard grows, and he's like, the suit says, I gots to save Christmas. They're Alaskan. That's an Alaskan
accent. Is that an Alaskan accent? Yeah. Really?
Yeah, I don't know if you're familiar. You ever
one
been?
To, 1 to 10 on the Rounceville scale. How Rounceville was that?
No, they're all white up there.
Are they?
Yeah. White or like Native American.
Well, we're just going to U-turn on this. What do you say we just go ahead and U-turn on that one? You want to know what? People are definitely on your side. Everybody in this chat room doesn't want to go to their holiday party.
See? It's because most people...
D8UV says he's Alaskan and that's super wrong.
I mean, super wrong because I nailed you or like super wrong
please
because...
Please do not pick a fight. Please do not pick a fight with Alaska right now. That's all I'm asking you.
Ah, they're so far away and there's so few people in it.
You're itching. All right, let's just go. Let's just go full bore. Get it out of your system. Let's push these couches back. Let's
actually
light it
really
up.
I really love Alaska. Alaska's beautiful. I've only been
is
once.
Is this like where you do
really
your
good.
Don Rickles setup?
My back.
Yo,
know,
my favorite thing about Alaska is...
It's beautiful, considering all the ugly people in
oh!
it.
Alaska will crush you with her $8 gallons of milk, says D8UV. Yeah, that is the thing about Alaska, right? You're living up there with the highest alcohol percentage in the nation and literally nobody around you, and bald eagles are as plentiful and bothersome as pigeons, and you're like, man, I'm really glad I get to pay for the privilege of being up here.
It's basic. I mean, it's kind of cool. Like, salmon is free, unlimited free salmon, and then you also get, like, a booze allotment from the state every year. Like, everyone gets their piece of the oil investment dividend.
Oh,
and
really?
So they get like, I don't know, like $800 per person per family just to spend on booze.
We're getting the real download here. D8UV says Alaska has the highest suicide rates and bald eagles are awful. They're dumb, terrible seagulls.
Terrible seagulls sounds like an oxymoron, though.
What? I mean, I guess, yeah. Nobody's like, hey, come here, my pet seagull, Edward, has learned a new trick. Everybody hates a seagull.
No, they're all terrible.
The BioGow's saying it's 2,000 a person.
I think it varies by year. It all depends on how well their investments did
that year. How well
the
oil goes?
Yeah.
Damn, no wonder why they were like drill baby drill up there.
Yeah, and also like you have to live there. You have to establish residency. So I want to say it's like 6 months. But then like every member of your family. So I have a family that popped out a baby on like December of 1 year and got an extra $1,000 from the state.
Where were we? We were in Christmas in July, and then we were on something else before that. Holiday parties. All right, so here's my thing.
Yeah,
I like a December 5th holiday party.
Okay.
Like, I want a holiday party to like kick off the holiday season.
Yeah.
Like right after Thanksgiving.
Okay.
Here's what you do.
I'm listening.
Friday. Half day.
Okay.
Or work from home. Your choice.
Uh-huh.
Right? So that's really the give back. The give back is you don't got to do a lot of work on this day.
And then when the party happens, it happens during that half day period that they gave you or later?
Like happy hour. Early. Early in the night. So here are the two elements that I'm a big fan of.
Okay.
Give people off of work.
Yeah.
Right? Happy hour starting Christmas party. Nobody wants a Christmas party that starts at 8
so
with a bunch of strangers.
So you go into work late? Or
you go to a bar. You know, I mean, like, so either you work from home or you go into work, and if you need to get stuff
done. So you go into work at like 8 a.m. You get off of work at like noon. Or 1, and then you go straight to the bar from there?
You can go home. You can change. You can do whatever you want. Your time is yours.
That's terrible. You just suggested a terrible thing.
Why?
Once I go home, I don't want to go back to work.
You're not going to
work. That's even worse than going to work.
You're going to a bar.
You're going to work. You're just going to work at a bar.
You can ditch, too. This gives you high ditch potential.
So what you're saying is your favorite holiday party is that get-together all of your friends have after work on any given day of the year.
But I don't pay for it.
All right. Touché.
Right?
I think the part you're forgetting.
I feel like you are just like you were just being obstinate.
No. I think that
you are
forgetting that like you and I have worked really hard to have this glorious lifestyle where we talk to a camera at 11 a.m. on a Friday.
Yeah.
And that most people
and you
people,
were late for it, by the way.
I blame my missing wife. But also More importantly, I think most people really don't like their jobs that much. I don't know that so many people like out and out hate it, but I think enough people are like, I really don't want to go today, and I really don't like these people.
Oh my God, dude, let's get into this, right?
Okay.
So this, BioCow has looked up the Alaska payment history.
Uh-huh.
Okay. 2011. Wait, is this per month?
No, a year.
Per year.
Yeah. And that's a lot of, like, portions of a cent. So to a decimal place.
2005, it was over 2,000.
Holy cow.
2016, it was just over a grand. The dividend was estimated to be 2,052. However, Governor Walker vetoed, reduced by approximately half. Oh, they're going to be crabby because the state ran out of money. Wait, I thought... so the state just needs more oil money, and so they can't pass it along to the
no,
people?
No, I don't think so. I think the dividend is, like, what... Like, above and beyond what they need to run the state. I might be wrong. I don't know all that much about it.
Yeah. What would you do? I mean, like... Would you want just a random, like, $2,000 to fall in your lap? Like...
I mean, that's kind of like the idea of basic income, right? Except this is a very
like
tiny
universal
piece.
Universal basic income,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I think I think it's a very interesting idea for a little further in the future. Like right now, I guess the problem I have is like we mentioned early on that
we're doing such important work that we don't want other freeloaders taking the money.
Oh no, not that at all.
Yeah,
that's it.
Especially those filthy Alaskans, right?
I was actually going to make this really personal. So here's my take on free money from the state in my world.
In your world.
In my world.
The world in which you could not make it on time for a work-from-home podcast. Go ahead.
In my defense.
Yeah, personal
also,
responsibility.
I don't get to work from home. I have to walk like a block to get here. Not like a city block. Not one of those 1 mile blocks.
We are working from my home right now.
Not one of those like 1 mile-long blocks. But like... A block in that there are small streets.
I really want to give our addresses up. My wife would literally spin kick my head off, but just so I could show to everybody what a hilariously small walk it is.
My address is on the internet. So free money. We mentioned that I live like this meager lifestyle in Oakland because I don't like to spend money. So like there is a point where like extra money right now doesn't do a lot for me. Like you could give me an extra like. $50,000 to $100,000 a year before like it starts to change the way I live my life.
Yeah.
And then like that's all mostly inconsequential to me right now. Like it's money that I would just put in a savings account and never think about. But if you gave me like $3 million or something, then we're starting to talk and I just like F off. You never see me again.
So what you're
I,
saying
like,
is
pull out of the public eye. I'm gone. Into the wind.
You would not leave.
I feel like
with
I would
million,
go far
where
away.
Where would you go?
Everywhere.
Oh, you would travel.
I would put down stakes somewhere where things are significantly cheaper than Oakland and probably more beautiful.
Okay.
I would fold into the island lifestyle and never be seen or heard from again. I actually don't know what I would do. I probably wouldn't go. You know what? Even if you gave me $3 million, I don't think it would change my life that much.
No, if I gave you $3 million right now, you'd just buy that like quadplex that you wanted to buy like four years ago.
That's probably true. Well, then I might not be in the public eye so much because I'm busy fixing that up and trying to figure out how to get the pocket door to work.
This is no joke. If I handed you $3 million right now, you'd borrow the extra million it took for you to buy the house that you wanted to buy, and you'd graduate to becoming a handyman. Full time. You'd be like, finally, now I can really play shims in pocket doors. Now it's really on. Drywall, here I come. On a lap of luxury.
You're right. You're right. I misguessed myself.
There's no part of you that wants to like I had this thing with Guts and Glory who just finished like a 3 month little,
oh, look, someone who can attest to how far away we live from each other. BioCow has, when Tom was in town, BioCow walked from my house to your house.
Yeah. A BioCow estimate in time how long it took you to walk from one place to another.
And then maybe in distance.
And then maybe in distance.
And then we'll see how wrong you are. Or right.
Your dad plays asks, did you have to walk to my house uphill both ways?
I actually, amazingly, it's downhill both ways.
Yeah, yeah. You could.
It's really embarrassing.
Like you could take a route that took you uphill both ways.
That is true. Yeah.
Yeah. But it would be dumb.
This is an effed up neighborhood, man.
It's weird.
It's just a bunch of weird hills. Drawn by Dr. Seuss.
So Guts and Glory, who are the design partners for the Contender, just took like a big sabbatical to Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
I almost want to read the list of ailments that befell one half of the couple, Fawn. Like, I had told them initially, like, you guys are going to be back in a month and a half.
Uh-huh.
Because they were driving down there. I'm like, you guys are workaholics. Like, you guys, like, you know, creativity is kind of your thing.
Yeah.
Like, and they work for themselves. And so it's like, at some point, you guys are going to want to do something. And, you know, that'll be that. You guys are going to come back. And then they totally didn't. They actually, like, really enjoyed just, like, you know, surfing and getting high and having a good time. So I don't know. I mean, maybe I just have a problem where I can't relax and I distrust vacation and I don't like it or the thought of it. Like
I enjoy vacation as long as novelty is still there. Like I really enjoy seeing things I've never seen before. I can get behind that all day.
Let me see if I can find.
Look, they're being creative. Look at all these pictures they're taking.
Oh no, their Instagram game is just off the chain. Like they just look fantastic. Oh, maybe they took this down, unless it was a super old post. But it was like the list of maladies that befell. Oh, here we go. Okay. I'm just gonna let you know this list goes 12 deep.
Yeah.
12 deep. They were in Mexico for like 3 months.
I'm ready. Number 7 looks like a really good story.
All right. Second degree 4-inch burn on leg day 3. Crap. I don't know. Some of this is personal. I don't know if I just want to read this. Severe diarrhea, 2-week-long antibiotic stretches, 3 trips to the clinic where I saw 3 different doctors who all had different diagnoses, 7 separate prescription medications, blood and stool samples taken. On a surf lesson, the board slammed into the head, knocking her out, fell on dirty streets sober and cut the leg open from the knee all the way down to the foot.
Jeez.
Still suffering from diarrhea and hasn't absorbed nutrients in over a month. On another surfing lesson, the big toe nail ripped halfway off, kept falling over onto the ground because she couldn't keep anything into her body. And on her last night in Mexico, walking to dinner, she tripped and ripped another hole in her leg.
Holy cow. Are the streets made of glass in Mexico?
They were in Sayulita.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's funny. So basically there's just like
the same place that, yeah.
Unbuilt buildings standing in her way everywhere.
So yeah, you know exactly where all that happened.
Yeah. Did you know that there is a reason why they don't finish building their buildings? Like, they purposely have rebar sticking out of the top of all of them because there is an extra tax once you finish the building?
Really?
Yeah. I mean, that's what some random stranger in Sayulita told me. Was it Sayulita?
Sayulita, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, like, we were playing this game. It's like Slugbug. So John and I were playing Slugbug, but instead it was rebar. So, like, every time you saw a building...
I want to spill coffee.
I know, that's funny. Every time you see a building with rebar sticking out of it, unfinished, you hit the other person.
You punch it.
So we hit each other like a lot. And it turned out that was why.
So yeah, I mean, I don't know what I would do with $3 million. I feel like I would just stay here. I feel like I would just buy... I would use that $3 million to borrow another million to buy a place.
Like
here.
$3 million is enough here to buy like an income property that you can live in forever. It's just enough to not be the right. It's just enough to get you in trouble if you were to try to buy like a single family home here. Because then you'd eat up all your cash buying the home, and then you'd still have crazy property taxes every year.
Yeah, man, it's expensive here.
Yeah.
Do you ever think it's not going to be expensive here?
I do a little bit.
You think the bottom's going to fall out at some point?
I think at some point. I think sooner or later, like, the tech starts to spread away from here, and then we see a drop.
But that would kind of be a softening, right? That wouldn't be like the bottom, like.
I mean, even if it's a softening, like, interests will catch up. Like, not interest, inflation will catch up.
Okay, so here, let's answer this. JV Phobic in our Twitch chat room. You can watch us, twitch.tv/JustinRYoung. Says, admit it. For what you two do for a living, living in Oakland is D-U-M-B.
False. Also, to be fair, it's not 3 million for a single family home. It's like a million for a single family home, but then you're going to have to start working again because of all the taxes.
Yeah.
And again, like, it's not dumb to live here. Like, I would say the only reason we both live here.
Hey, hold on. It's dumb, Brett. We work from home.
True or false? Do we not both live here? True or false? Do we not both live here because of what we do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we were brought out here for a job.
Well, yes, but now we also, like, what we do is still tied to this location, despite us being able to do most of what we do from anywhere.
Because our wives work.
Well, also because of that. Because the secret to our success is marrying people who do have jobs.
And they pay the bills.
Oh, it was a little bit sad because it's kind of true now.
I mean, hey, listen. We're both living off our wife's health coverage, right?
That's for sure true. Yeah. That is for sure true. Katie works for a hospital. So, like, we get great health care.
Yeah. Cullen 9 says $1 million would get me 25 acres and a 4,000 square foot house.
I bet it would get you, like, a nice 3-bedroom, 2-bath.
It would
here.
Get you a nice spot on Mission Street where you could pee on the side of the wall.
In San Francisco, it's even worse than here. But here you would get. Like, you would get to live in a really nice neighborhood.
A lovely closet-sized studio apartment where you could overlook the...
Oh, jeez. Actually, I don't want to say that.
The street flesh fair. What is that? What is it? What's the one, the thing?
Fulton Street?
The Folsom Street.
Folsom
fuck
Street.
Fest.
I don't think that's the technical name for it.
Should be.
But sure, you could be online anyway.
Yeah, JB Phobic. Number one, where do you live, JB Phobic? Because I'm curious what your frame of reference is. I can understand Amtraker working in the area for Mission Pick, because startup app. Of course, everybody go ahead and download Mission Pick. New stuff coming here?
Yes, less than 2 weeks.
Less than 2 weeks for new Mission Pick stuff.
Amazing new Mission Pick stuff. It looks incredible. I just couldn't be more excited to show it off.
But JB Phobic says, like, I could be online anywhere. Now, there is no doubt. So JV lives in Milwaukee. Milwaukee.
What's the
Algonquin
address? How far is the walk from here to your house, JV?
There are times where I fantasize about, like, man, you know, with the money that we're making, if Ashley could work from home and we could move somewhere. Like, we could actually get a house and we could, like, set up a real studio and we could, like, actually, like, install stuff for a kitchen and have space for a kitchen. And, like, there are elements that I'm like, oh, man, that would be really, really nice.
Yeah.
But then I'm like, oh, wow, like, you could do that if you live in Sacramento. And then I'm like,
Yeah.
And it's not that Sacramento's bad.
No.
Sacramento's all right. It's cool. There's some stuff there. It's just hard that, like, when you're around so much stuff and so many people,
yeah,
it's hard to leave that.
I think
we're both fairly. I mean, now you know you're taking care of Scarlett and everything, but like we're social people. Like, we like to connect.
I was taken aback. I had no idea that Oakland was so cool, and I sing its praises all the time now. But like, Katie and I have done the same thing because we come from, like, the mountains outside of Fresno. Like, the cheapest place you can live in California is where we were born and raised. And so we could move back there and practically live off of our savings for the rest of our lives. Like, we wouldn't have to do much at all to live our lifestyle. But then we'd have to live there, and we literally love it here. It's great. Katie, like, does not want to move anywhere else.
Yeah. Somebody asked, let me find it here. If you had to move, what would be your number one location to move?
If I had to move, I would probably move somewhere with the assumption that I wouldn't be there for longer than a few years. Like, I wouldn't think of it as a place that I was moving forever. And my favorite cities in America where I would like to experience living for a while are Boston and Austin.
Fort Collins, Colorado. Fort Collins, Colorado. Fort Collins, Colorado. Fort Collins, Colorado. And Fort Collins, Colorado, right?
I do like Fort
Is that
Fort
your
Collins.
Top five?
Fort Collins is in my top five, but it's not in my top three. I think
I'm going to tell him you said that. I'm going to tell him that you're a little
black. I'm going to call social. Hey, you remember Brett? No. He was the guy. No. Do you remember he ordered? No.
Well, he's got some shit to say about you.
Fort Collins is cool. I dig Fort Collins. But no, I would move to Colorado. I would move to Boston. I'd move to Austin. I think maybe that's it. Maybe I would leave it there.
What'd you deal with the snow?
No, I hate snow.
Then Boston, why is Boston in your top five?
That's why I said beforehand, like, it was a 2-year experiment. I would never move there forever. Same problem with Colorado. Here's the thing. Yeah. Negative temperatures?
Yeah.
Not even real. It's not a thing. I think that the whole world is lying to us. How is it possible that there's negative temperatures? That's like saying there's negative weather, which is like saying there's negative nature, which is the same as a negative tree. Have you ever seen a negative tree?
Like roots?
No, there's no such thing as a negative tree. How could there possibly be negative weather?
I mean, because we're trying to understand our natural world?
No!
No,
you're
not?
Wrong. It can't be negative. That's impossible.
So wait, hold on, wait. Celsius,
that's why you live in California.
Celsius,
so you never find out whether or not that's true.
Celsius is what? Celsius is where freezing is zero?
Yes.
Is that the difference?
Yes.
And then, like, Fahrenheit, it's freezing 32. Is 32 or
23?
32. Is it Magic Johnson, Michael Jordan?
Magic Johnson.
Magic Johnson?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. JV Phobic says, yes, snow and cold sucks balls, and we're looking at negative 20 and 8 inches of snow in the next 3 days.
Not okay.
Can't deal with it.
Let me just say that for you, where you live, that's D-U-M-B.
Oh, damn! Boy, oh, damn! The real scale is Kelvin. No negative weather. All right. Let me see what time we're at. Okay, we got time here. Do you want a Rogue One spoiler free review?
I haven't watched it.
No, that's why I'm saying
spoiler. Oh, do I want it?
Yeah. Do you want?
Because you watched it.
I watched it last night,
and you didn't call me at all, even once.
We talked to you. We said we were going to the draft house. We'd already gotten tickets.
No, you didn't.
Yeah.
Oh, like months ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. All right, fine. Carry on.
do you want spoiler free
thoughts? Yeah, fine, go for it. What do I care?
Well, what do you I mean, now you're just being a brat. You're just throwing your mic card around. Like, we don't have to.
Just do it. I don't care.
Are you just like pretending like this is how you're gonna treat Scarlett when she starts being fussy?
I just wanted to see it. I haven't seen it at all.
I might see it again.
Just go. Just tell the story. Just do it.
I already talked about it on the thing, on the stream. Did you not see my tweets about it?
No.
I was up late. So I stayed up till 4 o'clock in the morning.
Really?
Talking about this movie.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
Well, please don't make it that long.
I stayed up later interacting with the internet about this movie last night than I did for my friend's wedding. I flew to South Florida, went to a wedding, and I was asleep by 2 a.m. for that wedding. 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm still on Twitter. No, but for real!
All right, so then before you get started, where does it fall in the ranking of Star Wars movies?
All right, the ranking of Star Wars, you want it from top to bottom?
Sure, yeah.
All right, top to bottom. Empire.
Okay.
New Hope.
Okay.
7. Jedi. Rogue One. And then, I mean, put them in alphabetical order for the prequels. Like, they're just, garbage, trash, and haunted garbage.
So you didn't like it as much as you liked Rogue One. Did you stay up until 4 in the morning, or as much as you liked 7? Did you stay up until 4 in the morning after 7? I don't remember you being, like, that over the moon about it.
I was probably, I mean, to be fair, I was up until 4 o'clock in the morning because I saw the 11:30 showing.
Right.
So, like, that's part of it. I hated it.
You hated Rogue One?
Rogue One.
Really? I
hated it.
But you didn't.
Hated it!
But you didn't hate, that none of that made sense because you said that it was better than Jedi.
No, I said it was better than the prequels.
You also said it was better than Jedi.
No, I said 7 was better than Jedi.
Oh. All right. So you really disliked it? Like, honestly disliked it?
Yeah. It's not a good movie.
I think you're lying.
No.
No one else thinks
look,
that.
Look up my tweets. Look up my tweets. You want to know
That's
my
a hot
first,
take.
You want to know what my first tweet was?
What?
Rogue Y.
Oh, my God. You're a clever boy. Oh, man. I saw someone put their, like, order of good movies in,
yeah.
And I realized that, like, coming at Star Wars, watching it for the first time at 35, I think really, like, exactly reverse order is my favorite order. Like, I really love Jedi. Jedi is my favorite.
Yeah, you want to know what...
I mean, the new one. The new one's my favorite, but then of the old ones, Jedi's my favorite.
Yeah, you know, if now that I think about it more, like, I personally have a tremendous connection to Jedi. It was It came out the year I was born. It was the one that I saw first, like, as a kid. Obviously, like, you know, as a kid, Ewoks and Muppets and everything are just the best thing on Earth.
Totally.
Like, and there's just a lot to like about Jedi. Jedi, I think, gets a bad rap.
You it's get got a great heist Luke, story to start like, things out with.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's these fun little stories. I don't know what I expected out of Rogue One.
Were your expectations too high?
Ultimately, I don't think that's arguable.
Yeah,
considering I was very excited. So considering I bought tickets to go see it at 11:30 on Thursday.
Yeah.
I was very excited. It was like, at all costs, I got to see this ASAP in the draft house. Like, this is like a thing I need to do. I was all in for it. And I loved the premise. Like, I love the idea that, like, you could get away from all the things that at this point kind of, I think, can clutter a Star Wars story.
Mm-hmm.
Like the fact that everybody needs to be related and the fact that we're going to have these same kind of space battles and at some point someone's going to have to get something to a thing and yada, like there's just all these Star Warsian kind of tropes that I'm like, oh, great. So now they're just telling like all these other stories. They can be whatever the hell they want, right?
Yeah.
And then we just get all the tropes again.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So, but it's a completely self-contained story, right? Can you see? So, I'm so confused. I've seen so many people raving about this movie. Can you see in it the things that they are raving about?
There is a lot of fan service.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and not even really like, oh my God, wouldn't it be cool if this person did a thing with that stuff? But like Family Guy level, pan to the left, see people do a thing. Like pan to the right, let's get back to the story.
Like often?
Yes.
Wow. Weird.
It
was real bad, says Roebuck, a.k.a.
Yeah, I don't know. To be honest, I was shocked.
Huh.
I was blown away. I got a text from a mutual friend who lives in Los Angeles and is constantly in fear that his career will be ruined if he reveals his true black heart about pop culture. And it was like he literally had just gotten out of the theater as I was sitting down for my showing. And he's like, do you want to know what I thought? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, I hated it.
Oh, man.
And I was like, eh, whatever. He hated episode 7.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to call him after this movie so I can explain to him.
I mean, he only
why
hated,
this is great.
He only hated episode 7 for like the first 3 days, right? And then he loved episode 7?
He hated episode 7 so much that he wrote a 12-point takedown.
But then wrote.
And then wrote a rebuttal to his own 12-point takedown.
Right.
This person's a lunatic. He is a lunatic. He's a literal crazy person. Oh, Rob Kreckles in the chat room. What's up, Rob? How you doing?
Oh, hey, Rob.
Yeah. And so he was mostly, he was between Twitter and him, I was on the phone. I was literally on the phone for another hour after I got back. Oh, I actually went to sleep, and I was on the phone with him, and I was just like, just going over
and
all
another
stuff.
Thing. A was lot it, of it. Was it better or worse than when we stood on the corner for 2 hours complaining about Pacific Rim? Like, is the movie...
Is the movie better than Pacific Rim?
Yeah. Or, like, does the movie at least have,
are
like,
ready?
Less to complain about?
Are you ready for this?
Maybe I'm not.
Pacific Rim's a better movie than Rogue One.
What?
Yes. Yes.
That can't be possible.
It is. It's got clear narrative. Like, the story's dumb, but, like, also, whatever. It's a world in which big robots battle monsters that come
so
to save.
So Rogue One doesn't even have a clear narrative? It's a MacGuffin movie. Like, go get the thing. Okay, I got the thing.
No. Yeah, there is that, right? But also, it's like the logic to get there. Imagine if in Pacific Rim, they were like, oh, we found the thing that kills all the monsters.
Uh-huh.
Cool. Let's just somebody remember to tell somebody later that we already have it. We know what it is. Now let's just go on the rest of this adventure hoping that somebody doesn't get killed. But now we know we can do any number of plans. All these plans are now valid. But let's just pick this one crazy, stupid, dangerous one.
Oh. And so then they build a giant robot and try to punch the Death Star?
Here's the other thing, and I don't think that this is something that I think you should be prepared for going into it, mm-hmm. like that you could that you need to understand this is happening. Remember at the beginning of Ant-Man when they had a super young whatever, what's his butt?
Yeah. Michael Douglas.
That's like 10% of the movie are like CGI de-aged actors from episode 4.
Aww.
Like Grand Moff Tarkin.
I thought this was totally separate. I thought they weren't even going to talk about it.
Uh-uh.
I also don't know what Grand Moff Tarkin is.
He's the old, like the withery British guy from episode 4 who's like on the Death Star, and he's okay. like, oh, this is a Death Star and we will shoot and kill the stars with our death. Stop.
Oh, yeah, I remember that line of dialogue.
Like that, yeah. Remember this famous line?
It totally rings
line?
The bell.
This Rogue One doesn't have these classic Star Wars lines like, this Death Star is a real humdinger.
We'll shoot all the stars and cause all the death.
None of these stars will live after this Death Star gets done with them.
Sir, yeah, I think what we're implying is that we are the star that brings death. You're like, no, we kill stars. That's what we do. No, we kill planets.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of Uncanny Valley. Well, at least, I mean, like, I don't know. That's Rob's opinion that it's Uncanny Valley. To be fair, like, I didn't think it was terrible. I didn't think that the de-aging was, like, awful. It didn't take me out of the movie. There were other things that took me out of the movie or that made me not like it as much. There's one thing that I kind of want to ruin. I kind of just want to ruin one thing. Can I ruin
one thing? Go ahead. I had the entirety of all the other Star Wars ruined as completely as possible before I saw them.
This will be what we go out on. All right. So if you want to save yourself from this, either mute the stream. I'll wave when we're done talking, right? Or if you're listening to the podcast, just stop the podcast here. Download Mission Pick, buy the Contender, buy a sticker pack.
Yeah. All those
yada,
things.
Yada, yada, yada. The spoilers begin now. Darth Vader shows up for 2 scenes. Okay? So Darth Vader... Literally, it's just the main bad guy in the movie, who's new, a new character,
mm-hmm.
and he's, like, trying to figure out how to stop the rebels from getting the plans, and he screws up, and he goes to meet Lord Vader. Lord Vader comes out, and he's like, I'm Lord Vader, blah, 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 blah. And then he's like...
Does he say his name?
I don't know.
All right.
I mean, I'm doing an impression, so I have to say the name.
That's why I had to ask.
And the kind of internal struggle in the movie is our new character, the new bad guy, is like in this like inner office politics with Grand Moff Tarkin. And he's like, who gets credit for the Death Star? And Grand Moff Tarkin's like, I'm going to get credit for the Death Star. And he's like, no, but I helped build the Death Star. I deserve the credit. So he goes to Lord Vader effectively to see if he can get Darth Vader to tell the Emperor that he built the Death Star, right?
Uh-huh.
And at some point, Vader's like, I will inform the Emperor that ba-ba-ba. And dude's like, so you'll tell him? You'll tell him that I did this? And then he's like, oh. Darth Vader is facing the other direction. All right? So we are to believe that either Darth Vader is just showing off, that like he doesn't turn around to do the Force choke. He's just kind of either, there's only two ways this happens. Either he's doing it like through his body, right? So he's just like sitting here like he has like a brandy snifter. Like if you were just to shoot him from the front, he's just kind of like doing like this move in front of his chest, right?
Yeah.
Or he's like, like an and one basketball mixtape doing it between his legs.
Are we 100% certain that the guy didn't like really unfortunately he had lunch, storing a chicken bone in his cheek for later.
No.
Told his story and then was like, "Uh-oh.
We're not at the worst part yet."
Oh. All right.
Darth Vader then turns around and says, "What bad guy in the movie? Don't choke on your ambition."
Aww.
A pun! A pun! Yes, it's the best Star Wars movie of all time because now I finally got to see Darth Vader make a pun.
Oh, no.
A pun!
Why
he's supposed to be the most hardcore badass of all time, and he's making fun. Do you think he went back to his like his red sheet buddies that like hang out next to him? He's like, "Did you hear it? I said choke while I was choking him. Do you think he got it? Do you think he's gonna tell? Do you think he's gonna steal it? I bet you the Emperor steals it. The Emperor's oh my classic Emperor. He's gonna steal it." All right, that's it. Let's go ahead and wrap it up. I just ruined the movie for Brett. Okay, everybody. Brett and Justin work from home.
Bye-bye.
Oh, man.
Hey, my wife's alive.
Hey, look at that. Hey, Daniel J. Newman. Welcome. Puns are so evil. Yeah. So here, waving. We no longer. Yeah, spoilers are over. Clear the chat. Yeah. I'm shocked that it's gotten as good reviews.
Yeah, I guess I am now too. What is that? Oh, look, I did set an alarm for today. 11:45.
All right, guys. Let me go ahead and take a look. How long have I been up? All right. Next amount of time. All right, guys. Cool. Thank you so much for watching.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to shut this thing down. But
we never once talked about a single female lawyer on camera. Was that the gag?
I guess so, yeah.
It is now.
Yeah. Single female lawyer, baby. Did I never update it?
Thanks for watching.
Am I in IRL or am I in talk show? Oh, whatever. We're gone now. I love you guys.
Bye, gang. Good to see you all.